drink water after a meal puts out the fire of digestion. So, but at the same time, you don't want to just put all food in the solid food into the stomach. You have to be sure to have enough liquid there. So drinking water is very important. There's this one doctor in Vrindavan. A lot of devotees have been going to see this one doctor. And he has everybody drink, you have to drink 9 liters of water a day. Yeah, a lot, several devotees have been doing it. Marichi's wife, she did it, she was doing it. You have to do that for like 3 months or something. They say if you do that for like 3 months, every day drink 9 liters, then you'll be very healthy. But pretty difficult. 9 liters of water. It's a lot of water to drink. Just to drink 2 liters of water a day. You drink 9 liters. It's very powerful. Cleaning out the stomach, cleaning out all the garbage from the, all the stool that is there in the body. Okay, anyway, regulation. The regulation is the purpose, and then yukta, controlling the senses. We have to control the senses. A devotee is supposed to be controlled in the sense activities. So we should be regulated in our eating. If you're regulated in everything, then it's much better for the health. If you're not regular, you eat anything, any time of the day and night. There are places here in Thailand, I know in Malaysia, that have these restaurants open 24 hours. At any time of the day and night, you can go and get food. Customers are coming. People are going, eating, sitting, eating, drinking in the middle of the night. So this is not a very healthy lifestyle. If you're regulated in these activities, eating and sleeping should be regulated also. If you get regulated, just like we try to regulate devotees waking up in the morning, sleeping in a particular time and waking up at a particular time. You get regulated, the body is like a machine, it becomes adjusted. It can becomes, you know, we don't think anything of it. Naturally you wake up. In the beginning, you know, you need an alarm clock and and it's difficult to wake up. But after some time you become regulated to the body itself naturally wakes up in the morning and you want to get up. So sleeping, Prabhupada often said, sleeping is like death. Compared it to death. And we have the example, and Prabhupada gives the example here also, Rupa Goswami, or the Goswamis of Vrindavan. It is said, Nidrahara Vihara Kadhijito. They conquered over eating and sleeping. Nidra and Hara. They conquered over eating and sleeping. So this is actually the advanced stage of sense control, that you can regulate eating and sleeping. Prabhupada said when he was a young man, he conquered over mating and defending. And he said, now in my old age, I have also given up eating and sleeping. Because Prabhupada, in his final year, he was not able to eat much. He was not able to sleep either. So he said, well, I was young, I conquered eating, making and defending. He said, now I have also given up eating and sleeping. So these four activities, eating, sleeping, defending and making, this is the animal activities. This is the business of the material senses. And we want to regulate them. And we want to, you know, gradually even you can give them up. Eating, sleeping. The Goswamis, they didn't worry about eating. They didn't worry very much about eating. A little bit of butter they would eat. They could be very renounced. But we, of course, we can imitate, right? And we're not expecting to imitate. But just like it was mentioned, don't eat too much, don't eat too little. Don't sleep too much, don't sleep too little. Sometimes we've seen devotees try to sleep very less, you know, waking up very early in the morning, and being very, very renounced. Just like Bhakti Tirthar Swami, when he was a brahmachari also, you know, he was extremely renounced. But the problem was, it was very difficult for anybody to be with him. You know, if he would go on a party or he'd go with somebody else, nobody else could tolerate it, because he would wake up so early in the morning and be chanting and you know, and be hardly eating, never thought about eating, and hardly anything to eat. So for other devotees, you know, they just thought, wow, you know, they didn't want to be with him. So nobody had wanted to travel with him. He was all on his own. So that's one problem which comes when you're too much renounced, you know. And sometimes people, I remember there was one boy who joined in London, and for some time he was very, very renounced. And then, but then after some time he gave up Krishna consciousness and went away. So the renunciation was premature. It was not practical. There was one man, he was an American black body devotee, and he'd been in Africa, and he came back from Africa and to Mayapur, and he went to live in the banana plantations. He went to live among the banana trees, and he wouldn't eat prasadam with all the devotees. But he would come after the prasadam, and he would take some of the remnants, what was left on the plate. So they told Prabhupada about this, and Prabhupada was not pleased. And Prabhupada said his devotee should stop all this behavior. Behave like a normal person. And we see Raghunath Das Goswami, he also got instruction like that from Lord Chaitanya. Raghunath Das, as a young man, His mother and father, the family were very, very wealthy. In fact, they were so wealthy, they were maintaining all the brahmanas of Bengal. They were maintaining all the brahmana community. But Raghunath Das wanted to join Lord Chaitanya's movement. And he came to Lord Chaitanya and requested Lord Chaitanya that, "I want to give up everything and come and be with you." And Lord Chaitanya chastised him and told him, "Don't talk like this. Behave like a normal person. Go home and just be a normal person. And keep Krishna in your heart." So like this, Lord Chaitanya tested Raghunath. He said, "You go home and you stay with your family and be a normal person. Don't be a madman." You get people, some devotees, they want to be a madman, you know. But it's artificial, it's not real, it's not genuine. Premature transcendence, we would say. Premature transcendence. They're not actually ready for that level of renunciation. So Lord Chaitanya tested Raghunath, he sent him home, and he went home and he behaved normally, but at the same time he was renounced. He stayed at home, but at the same time he was renounced. And then later on he got the mercy of Lord Nityananda, and Lord Nityananda blessed him. With the blessings of Lord Nityananda, he was able to leave his home. And then he came to Jagannath Puri, to Lord Chaitanya, and Lord Chaitanya told him, "You're very fortunate that you were living in a, you were like an animal who'd fallen in the bottom of a well full of stool. You were living in that with all these materialistic people in this very in a very materialistic environment. So you're very lucky to be free from that. So Kur Raghunath became gradually more and more renounced. At first his family sent money to him and brahmanas and everything to cook for him. So he would arrange a feast and he would invite Lord Chaitanya to come and he'd feed Lord Chaitanya. But then after some time he sent them back. He sent them home. He didn't, don't want you anymore, go home. And so Lord Chaitanya said, what happened? He said, no, he said, it doesn't feel right that I'm taking the wealth of these materialistic people. So then how did Raghunath look? He was begging at the door of the temple. And people would come and they would give prasada. Because he was a sadhu and he was begging, so they would give. But then after some time he stopped that. And Lord Chaitanya said, what happened? He said, oh, it didn't feel right. Because I stand there, but I know some people are going to give. It's not good. I didn't like the idea of just standing there depending on these people to feed me. So then how are you eating? Then Raghunath, he would go to the drain and he would get the rice and he would wash it and dry it and then he would eat it. And he was eating all the caught there from the drain, from the pots which they would wash in the temple. And he would eat that at those remnants. And Lord Chaitanya said, oh, this is nectar, give me some. So, of course, this was Raghunath. He was extremely renounced. He was known for his renunciation. But we cannot imitate that kind of standard of renunciation. But we have to be regulated. Don't eat too much, don't eat too little. If you're regulated, you're very healthy. People eat too much, diabetic. Eat too little, tuberculosis. It's a problem. And sleeping too much, you just waste the human life. And you don't sleep enough, it's also a problem. I was in Hong Kong, there was one Chinese lady, she had not been able to sleep for 2 years. 2 years couldn't sleep. Some people, when people are in great anxiety, they're not able to sleep. So this is a problem, because the mind is so disturbed. Cannot sleep. If you don't sleep properly, you can't rest. We should sleep in order to use the body for the service of Krishna. Of course, gradually you should try to reduce that also. And Prabhupada recommends, he says 6 to 7 hours is enough rest actually for the body. If you sleep more than that, you may sleep a little more. Some people need more. Just like eating. Some people need to eat more. Some people have the bigger body, they need to eat more. Okay, you can't criticize it. Some people can eat very less, and they don't have any problem. The people have different bodies. In the same way, some people, they need more rest, and some people, they can manage with less rest. Not everybody is the same. So we understand there's variety. But regulation. We shouldn't take advantage to eat more unnecessarily, even when we're not hungry, eating more is not good. The tongue, there should be some control, not eating all the time and breathing all. So we have the Krishna conscious program. Usually we eat the main meal in the midday, right? The chapatis, dal, rice, dal, chapati is a staple food. That's the meal for the midday. And then in the morning, khichdi or something lighter, like that. Some lighter food. And in the evening, we would have a glass of milk. That used to be the program. So you keep, when you're regulated, that we can avoid. The mind is very peaceful because you know what's appropriate. You're not thinking, are we going to have prasadam? You're not thinking, well, am I going to have some rest? If you're regulated, you know exactly what you're going to do at a particular time. So the body becomes adjusted to that regulation. Just like we get regulated to sleep at night. And when you regulate, you go to sleep. You fall asleep easily. Okay, any questions? Come on.
Marge, that day you were mentioning about Sati Mata telling that Chitraketu was uncivilized. But my question wasn't Shivji uncivilized, because I don't think it was appropriate to be embracing her while everyone was there.
Well, he's a very special person, no?
So my question was, he should have set a good example.
Yeah, Chitraketu hadn't actually made a very great offense, but because, well, she was a superior personality, so we should respect superior personalities. It's not our position to criticize superior persons. Just like people criticized, there were some demigods, the sons of Marichi, they criticized Brahma for chasing after his daughter. And the result was they were cursed. They had to be killed by Kamsa. They took birth as the sons of Devaki and were killed by Kamsa. So we have to respect superior personalities. It's not our position to judge Lord Shiva. Just like you may criticize Lord Shiva for smoking a ganja. But who are we to criticize? We have no position. We have to respect the superior person. That is the Chitraketu. His offense, it wasn't really an offense. It was a very minor breach of etiquette. But Sati, by the arrangement of the Lord, Sati had to put the curse. But it was a blessing for Chitraketu. It was a blessing because it gave Chitraketu the opportunity to become free from all of his karma and to go back to God. He took birth as a demon. You see, even taking birth as a demon, he didn't lose his devotion for the Lord. That's an important point. That he didn't lose any of his devotion. Even though he was in the demon body, he was still a devotee. Even though he was fighting Indra, he was still a devotee. He was attached to the Supreme Lord.
Well, as we did say about Lord Shiva, he is smoking ganja. In India, so many people, Lord Shiva, do like that. How can preaching to this kind of person, how can preaching to the thousands of people?
How to preach to
them? How to preach to these people? Imitation to Lord Shiva.
I was reading Shruta Kirti's book about this aspect. He was telling one time Prabhupada told them, he said his father used to buy ganja and give it to some of the sadhus because he knew the sadhus sometimes, you know, they needed to smoke ganja just to be peaceful. It's in Shruta Kirti's book. Have you read it? You're reading that book, right? You've seen that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
It's in Nepal, in the Sivaratri time, the main temple is possibly of Lord Shiva. So many people, they come from India. So the government gives every sadhu small wood, you know, for burning, because it's cold that time. They come in the winter, the Sivaratri falls around winter. And they also give them ganja. So it's like a whole packet, like, you know, here the Buddhist monk given some milk, and here they give like that, you know.
Ganja.
Yeah. The government or the temple itself gives.
Okay.
especially on that day, everyone, you know, they take, as Prabhupada was saying, everyone takes like prasad. Even small children, you know, they hang and they put it, they say it's prasad, and we all take like.
So how to preach to that people? How do we preach to people? Give them prasadam and kirtan. Get them attracted to the pure intoxication. The pure intoxication is chanting the holy name, Krishna prasadam. Don't let them get attracted to these things. There are many, there have been several cases of people who were sadhus or shivais and so on, that became devotees by Krishna chanting and joining the kirtan, having some nice prasadam, and they became intoxicated. The higher things, pure intoxication. People would come to Prabhupada, they would say to Prabhupada, you haven't tried this, you haven't tried this LSD, you haven't tried this marijuana. And Prabhupada would say, I have not tried, but my disciple, he has tried. You know, and they would stand up and say, yes Prabhupada, we have taken it. We say chanting Hare Krishna is better.
More high.
We get more high.
Question about that, you said about the artificial, what was that, the term that you used, is premature transcendence, right? How do you know, because you know, sometimes we are, many times we are saying, you know, the body, we should minimize the body necessities, and then we tend to push ourselves, maybe, you know, sometimes too much, and then, you know, how do you know if we are artificially doing it, or you know, what is the limit where you know when we know that you know it's not working for me, or you know it's premature?
Well, there's a certain standard. The standard is you should take prasadam. You may take a bit more prasadam sometimes. Okay, that's not a problem. But it should be prasadam. You shouldn't have to take some. You're going to take some. It should be prasadam. You have to follow certain principles or certain minimum standards. You can't take intoxication, you can't gamble, beat anything, illicit sex. These are not allowed. You know, you want these things, you want to eat, okay, you can eat prasada. You want to gamble, okay, gambling, we don't gamble. You want to give up gambling. The sex urge is there, the sex urge is dealt with in Krishna consciousness, in married life. And sleeping, you have to sleep enough to maintain the body for the service of Krishna. Right? Yeah. You don't have to, we should really wake up for the Mangal Arti. Okay, you can get. Can't get up from Mangal Arti, then actually, if you're in the temple, everybody will wake up from Mangal Arti. You're feeling tired, you take rest in the daytime. You can't take rest in the daytime, then you come home a little earlier, take rest a little earlier in the evening. But gradually, the body can become regularly. The problem is our mind. Our mind thinks I need more sleep. The mind thinks I'm tired. The mind thinks I'm hungry. The mind thinks, oh, I'm starving. I'm going to die if I don't eat. You know, the mind, it's the mind. The problem is the mind. I have to conquer over your mind. So chanting Hare Krishna. Engagement in the service. Just practice. We beginning it seems difficult, but if you keep practicing without thinking about it. Four regulated principles in the beginning seems, wow, four principles, I don't know if I can follow all these four principles, there's a lot, you know, how to do this. But gradually, you know, living in the association with the learning teacher. But before being a devotee, it sounds very difficult. Wake up in the morning at 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock in the morning? How to wake up at that time? Mm-hmm. Gradually, in the association with the devotees, it can do. Okay? Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki.
Yeah.
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 Yeah.